Am I audible?
Yeah, Ravindra is going to talk on his work along with Raghavan and Abhik. Yeah, go ahead, Ravindra.
How is my screen visible in full screen
it's a
mode?
Bit small. You're in basically, I think, presenter mode. Maybe you want to switch to.
Okay. Okay. I'll make things simpler. Right, is it all right now?
Not yet. It is still in presenter mode. Yeah, now it's better. Okay. Yeah, please go on.
Okay. Thank you. Good morning. My name is Ravindra. I'm from TCS Research. This work is done along with Professor Raghavan Komandur and Abhik Rai Chaudhary from NUS Singapore. The title of the talk is Fitness Graded Vulnerability Detection with the Gray Box Fuzzing. So fuzz testing uncovers basically runtime errors by executing the program with many test inputs. Okay, these test inputs are automatically generated. There are three types of fuzz testing. So one is black box testing, where the test inputs are generated randomly and it's independent of the program. And so the fuzzer need not know anything about the program. They are popular. They found a lot of bugs in Unix utilities. And even now they are quite popular tools like Preach, fuzzers. They are all black box fuzzers. And there are the white box fuzzers, which systematically explore the program paths using symbolic execution techniques and constraint solving techniques. They find very deeper bugs, but they suffer from scalability issues. Today's talk, the focus is on gray box fuzzing, which generate test inputs from a population of existing test inputs, where the test objective is guided by the program execution profile. The reason why I highlighted this population and objective will come in a minute. So generally the gray box fuzzing, today especially the gray box fuzzer that I'm going to talk about is based on the genetic algorithms. And you know, genetic algorithms are inspired by the choice of, it's a set heuristic inspired by the theory of natural selection, where the fittest individuals are selected and to produce the population, new population or the population space. So here the population is new test inputs. So it uses very lightweight instrumentation. So there are two popular techniques in the gray box fuzzing. One is coverage guided, where the test objective is to cover maximum parts of the code, where the fitness metric is essentially the new branch widget. That means a test input is considered to be fit if it leaves the execution to visit a new branch. Okay, the other one is a other type of fuzzer is directed fuzzers, where the test objective is to reach a particular target error location, where the fitness metric is the CFG distance from the target location. So if the test input reduces the distance, it is considered to be fit. So AFL is a very well-known coverage guided gray box fuzzing tool, which found several security vulnerabilities. So at a high level, the gray box fuzzing tool works as shown in this figure. So the program is first instrumented for the coverage and then compiled, and the program is executed on a initial seed inputs. Give me a second. Okay, on a given initial seed inputs, the program is executed, and the coverage that creates the coverage profile, and then the fitness is computed. If the test input is deemed found to be fit, it is added to the test population. And from then from this population, from this population, the next test input is selected, and a potential of this test input is computed. Then several offsprings of this test input is generated. These offsprings are once again run, and you know their fitness is computed to see if they are fit. You know, if you take the branch coverage as a fitness, if the generated offspring covers a new branch, it is considered to be fit and added to the population. Otherwise, it is discarded. And this process repeats until the time budget is complete or the test objective is met. Okay, so here I illustrate this using an example. This is a program where it reads the input into a 500 bytes buffer, and then it fills the output buffer unconditionally when it sees a B character in the character B in the input. Okay, input INP. And if you observe, this program has a buffer overflow vulnerability. When if the input contains more than 250 characters of B, the buffer overrun occurs at the program location 5 here. Okay, so I labeled the branches of this program, which is A, B, C, D. Okay, so the way fuzzer works is first initially the fuzzer starts with the initial seed input, in this case let us say A, and then it executes the program. Then the program takes this red color path. Okay, and here if you observe, the coverage profile, or what we call branch pair profile, is created for this input, where AB here indicates this pair of branches visited by the there seems to be a so AB, the fuzzer actually tracks the branch pairs rather than a branch. So here the branch pairs are nothing but consecutive conditional branches. So here AB is one branch, AC is another branch pair, and BA, and so on. So if you look at this test input, it actually goes through this branch pair AC. So there is a one here, and then it leaves this loop via this branch D. So there is a branch pair CD. It visited one time each of this. Now this this is called branch pair profile. Now this test input is fuzzed. You know, the fuzzing is nothing but there are several mutational operators, by like adding bytes, flipping bits, flipping bytes, arithmetic operations, and so on. So assume that it generated these three inputs A, B, and C. Then let us execute this program now with B. So this B will take this red color path when we execute the program with this B, and its execution profile is it goes through AB and BD. Okay, so since its execution profile or the branch pair profile is different from previous test input, this B is retained. Okay, note that if you look at, we reach the control location where the buffer overflow is occurring, but merely reaching the control, merely reaching this location through control flow execution does not expose this vulnerability. So this is point one. And so now there are several mutational operators. Let us continue. For the illustration purpose, I use this mutational operator called add bytes, which adds, you know, expands the input. Okay, in this case, let us assume that we have added 60, the fuzzer created a new test input by adding 65 B characters to the input B. So the execution, once again, the branch pair profile created is something like this with AB and BA. Now there is this input, test input, the branch pair profile is different from previous profile. So this test input is retained. Next thing is, let us add another 65 more, and now this the branch profile looks something like this. Now the question is whether this test input is retained or not for further fuzzing. So the AFL strategy not only to retain just new branch whenever the new branch pair is visited, but the new branch pair is visited significantly different number of times. What is this significantly different means? Two visit counts are said to be significantly different if they differ on a logarithmic scale by one. So if you see the on the logarithmic scale, 131 and 66, you know, is greater than or equal to one. So this test input is retained. However, if you add, 65 bytes more, you will increase the length of the test input by to 196. But this test input, if you observe, its visit count is compared to the previous profile is not any greater than one. So this test input is not retained, so it is discarded. So now if I want to hit the vulnerability, what need to be done is we have to add 120 B characters. But generally the, to make fuzzer very effective, large mutations are discouraged, or they are only tried very less frequently at much later stages of the fuzzing. This is to maintain, this is one of the design philosophy of the fuzzer, to maintain its fuzzer effectiveness. So it is less likely to hit, it takes, fuzzer takes longer time to hit this, bug and exploit this vulnerability. So there are other issues with the coverage guided fuzzers. So coverage guided fuzzers are basically, undirected, sorry for the type of unguided, undirected. For example, to illustrate, in order to exploit this buffer overflow vulnerability here at line number 5, we need to test input, we need to drive the execution through this branch with large number of Bs. However, if we fuzz it but we add non-Bs more, it is of no use, right? So but mutator does not know how, whether to add B or non-B, even though it can add large, but it doesn't know which one to add. So that's another problem. They simply adding large mutations does not guarantee of exploitation of vulnerability. So to mitigate, our main contribution is how to, make a fuzzer effectively take such vulnerabilities. So our proposal is to instrument the vulnerability points, which are nothing but a set of locations in the program where the vulnerability can be potentially exploited. And note that these vulnerability points are very specific to a vulnerability type. For example, in case of buffer overrun, it can occur at the statements where a pointer dereference is done. That is where the pointer is pointing to a particular buffer. And we propose to measure how close each test input comes in exploiting the vulnerability at each vulnerability point. And we retain those test inputs that are close are closer, getting closer in exploiting the vulnerability at a vulnerable point, even though the branch profile is not close, to the previous test inputs. So we call this headroom, which I'll illustrate it in a minute, which is a proxy for this closeness of exploiting the vulnerability. So I'll illustrate what is this notion of headroom using buffer overrun. So here in this case, vulnerability points are each buffer write locations in the program. We consider only buffer writes. Okay. But how to measure this closeness of a test input exploiting the vulnerability at each vulnerable point? Let us look at in our example where out the contents of the out be. With each of the test input, you can see this green thing is the amount of buffer that gets filled with the input. Okay, if you see, if you calculate this percentage of buffer filling, okay, that is what we use as a proxy to the closeness. The lesser the percentage, it is more, the test input is more close to exploiting the vulnerability. So essentially for this vulnerability, the headroom is uninitialized portion of the buffer. Okay, so for the same thing in case of integer overflow, each arithmetic statement each arithmetic statement is the vulnerability location, and headroom represents the max, the difference between the maximum value of an integer that that can be represented by an integer to the current value of the variable. Okay, so now with this, let us revisit our example where previously we discarded the test input with 196 bs. Now with this, our approach, what happens is in addition to the branch pair profile, we also measure the headroom. Okay, we separately maintain the headroom, which you can see here. And now the criteria to retain is not only the significant different number of times of new branch visit counts, but it is also the headroom. So though in this case, because of the visit counts, this test input is discarded, but because its headroom is significantly different from the previous headroom, this test input is retained. Now, after retaining this test input, if we add another 65 bs to this, then effectively we exploit the vulnerability. So this is the key idea of our work. And with this addition, how our approach works is basically we, in addition to the branch coverage instrumentation, we'll also do vulnerability specific instrumentation. And in addition, while running the program, in addition to the coverage profile, we create a vulnerability profile as well. And we evaluate this profile against previous headroom profiles. And if it is closer, then we will add that to the population of the test inputs. Even though this may also choose to retain or ignore it, discard it, we will, our approach will, in additionally retain these test inputs. Then the select next input selects the test inputs in a round robin manner between coverage and the vulnerability specific test inputs. And the compute potential also add extra potential, which is inversely proportional to the headroom. Okay, that means the closer the lower the headroom, it will add more number of more so that the vulnerability can be exploited. So we implemented this approach. We call this as AFL-HR by extending AFL. Okay. And we, in this implementation, we maintain two test input populations. The logic required to retain the test inputs based on the fitness of a particular vulnerability is added. And we have changed the scheduling of selecting the next
Ravindra, am I the only one?
Voice is
not able to hear Ravindra properly.
Ravindra, your voice is breaking. Ravindra?
Sorry, is my audio not? Yeah. Is it okay now or is it still?
Yeah, better now.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, somehow this happens in middle to my arbitrary this thing. Okay, so we have essentially developed the instrumentation for buffer overrun, where we instrument every location of this star PTR equal to expression. That means we instrument the buffer writes. We use point to analysis, static point to analysis to determine the buffer. I mean the buffer or a heap that a pointer is pointing to. So, and we also, you know, our instrumentation also put the headroom calculation. Similarly, for integer overflow or points, you know, we target the expressions like, you know, w equal to v plus or minus u, or w equal to v into u. The headroom calculation is, you know, used by width extension test, which is very popular in integer overflows. So we targeted arithmetic expression that use 32-bit integers only. So we have used, for buffer overflow, we have used 8 MIT benchmarks that have identified 46 buffer overflow vulnerabilities. And we have used 177 SVCOM benchmarks with 177 integer overflow. Per program, there is one integer overflow. So we compared our fuzzer performance with AFL and AFLGO, which is a direct, AFLGO is a directed fuzzer. Buffer overrun tool we ran, executed for 3 hours on each benchmark. And integer overflow we ran for 900 seconds, which is the SVCOM standard. And each test execution is repeated 5 times, and all executions are started from the same initial seed input of all the fuzzers. So at high level, you know, this graphic shows the results of our experimentation. So our approach found far higher vulnerabilities, 29 out of 46 for the buffer overrun experiments, whereas AFLGO found 19 and AFL found 16. And we also found it very fast. In the first 1 hour, our approach could find 26 of the vulnerabilities, whereas AFLGO and AFL could find 17 and 16 respectively. On the integer overflow, our approach found 148, whereas the others also very close by. But if you observe, you know, in first 15 seconds itself, we found maximum number of vulnerabilities. Compared to the other tools, the nature of these programs are, they are very amenable to finding these bugs. So in summary, we address the challenging problem of exposing vulnerabilities graded by vulnerability specific fitness metric. We implemented it as an extension to AFL and Graybox fuzzing tool. We evaluated our approach on buffer overrun and integer overflow. And our approach could find many more vulnerabilities found very quickly compared to AFL and AFLGO. Subsequent to this work, we wanted to evaluate on much larger realistic benchmarks. And also we found there are some inefficiencies in our approach, which we wanted to mitigate. I'll quickly cover that part. So the shortcomings of AFL HR implementation is, there is an instrumentation overhead. Because of already there is a coverage instrumentation, on top of that we are adding our own instrumentation, which slows down the fuzzer, which further impacts the coverage itself. So it will reduce overall effectiveness of the fuzzer. And also we have static points to analysis, which is for buffer overflows, which is quite expensive and imprecise, not so suitable for large applications. So taking this into consideration, we have designed a new fuzz extension called HDR fuzz. This is contributed by 2 interns. So here at high level, the HDR fuzz is we kind of separated vulnerability specific module from the main fuzzer. The key idea is that we maintain, we take 2 copies of the program, same program, and instrument differently, one for coverage instrumentation, one for vulnerability specific instrumentation, and the fuzzer will fuzz normally like AFL does it. And whenever, you know, on a strategy basis, it will ask vulnerability specific module, is this test input interesting to you, okay, with respect to the vulnerability. The vulnerability specific module will execute this program with vulnerability specific instrumentation and check. It does the fitness check against the vulnerability and say yes or no. Based on that, fuzzer will retain it and fuzz it further. If in case it caused a crash due to vulnerability manifestation, that will be retained by the vulnerability specific module. So we have implemented this, and you know, due to time constraint, what I just want to summarize, we have implemented by extending the ASAN address sanitizer, which is from LLVM. ASAN is a very popular runtime memory leak detector. We have modified, but it can only detect vulnerabilities if it writes
not again breaking up. Again breaking up, Ravindra.
Is it okay?
No, still breaking up. Okay.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you're better now.
Okay, sorry.
But maybe just try to wrap up, right, and we'll have a quick couple of questions.
Right. So HDR first found significantly more errors compared to the AFL-HR. So we have done experiments on CGC and FTC. So this is related work. So AFL-GO does directed fuzzing, but it is based on the control flow distance. Fuzz Factory is a generic framework that where it can be instantiated for different types of vulnerabilities, but our technique cannot be instantiated using Fuzz Factory. And white box fuzzing is not scalable, and generally the bugs that are induced on longer execution path, it suffers a lot. SBSP approaches, they rely on different types of metrics. Their innovation is more on the finding different types of metrics, fitness metrics, and they also typically use Boolean distance metrics. Okay. So in summary, we have implemented two variants of fuzzers, AFL-HR and HDR fuzz. Both are for same purpose, finding the vulnerabilities, but HDR fuzz is faster than AFL-HR. In future, we want to evaluate this on more realistic programs and instantiate our approach to other challenging type of vulnerabilities, such as memory leaks. Okay, so with that, I come to end of my talk. Any questions?
Thank you, Ravindra. So we have time for quick question or two. Anyone?
Yeah, Ravindra, Meenakshi here.
Yeah, hi, Meenakshi.
Yeah, thanks for the nice talk. I just wanted to know, how are the vulnerabilities given? I mean, how do you use them while working on this case generation?
Sorry, come again?
The vulnerabilities, how are they given? How are they specified? How do you use them in the algorithm?
We use the, we use vulnerabilities, so we design a specific metric specific to the vulnerability. So we identify the vulnerability points, Ravindra, which are location.
Ravindra, he's asking if the vulnerabilities are an input to the approach. I don't think they are.
No, they are not input to the approach. So we automatically try to identify all potential vulnerabilities using an approach like static analysis or something, and we instrument those locations, be it buffer overflow or integer overflow. So the kinds of expressions that we look for while identifying those locations are for buffer overflow, it is star PTR equal to, I mean, buffer writes, essentially, any buffer writes. And in case of integer, any arithmetic operations that involves 32-bit integers.
Yeah, so vulnerabilities are specific program points.
Right, specific program points.
Okay, thanks.
Ravindra, Deepak here. So this AFL Go, that also does some kind of directed fuzzing. So you said based on some distance, you know, from the point that you want to reach in the CFG. So why did that work for you all? I mean, once you've identified these program points, these vulnerability points.
Right. So I think I'll quickly go back.
So Deepak, the vulnerability points are identified by our approach. They are not given. Maybe there's some
mistake. Right. No, but once you've identified that,
identifying is the problem. Once you identified, it's done.
Sorry, Arun.
No, identifying the vulnerability points is the problem statement. Once you've identified them, you don't need to call AFL Go or anything else.
Oh, I see.
Now, your question is why AFL Go does not work in this case.
For example, for the buffer overflow, you say you target points where you're dereferencing that array pointer.
Right.
So once you've identified those points, right, then why can't you use AFL Go?
The thing is, AFL Go is targeted to reach that vulnerability point, like the way I have shown here. Okay, it's a control flow reachability is what they target. Okay, often the AFL the branches in the program could be so difficult to reach. So difficult. Reaching the control location of the vulnerability itself is a challenging. AFL Go is targeted to reach such a difficult vulnerability locations, using control flow distance. It's not exploiting the vulnerability. Once they reach, their job is done. They further pass it. Whereas ours is reaching is not enough. I showed here, it reaches, but it does not exploit the vulnerability.
Want to reach under some condition, under some.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
All right. Thank you, Ravindra. Thanks for the talk. We'll probably move on to the next speaker. Let me stop recording.